Thank you, Jim. If you think it's dark right now, you should have been at the 8:30 service. I knew they were out there because I could hear them snoring. But not really. They're an alert group. But it did make me think of a story that Spurgeon told. He was a guest speaker at a church. He came with his sermon prepared. And as he's sitting on the platform, he was disturbed because a new sermon began to form in his mind, and he felt this definite prompting to preach it. But the problem was he only had 2 points and he needed 3 points for a sermon. So he debated whether he would do this or not, play it safe or step out on faith. And just before he went to the pulpit, he decided, I'm going to preach this new sermon that's formed in my mind. And he did. And he preached the first point, he preached the second point, and he came to the end of it. He still didn't have his third point, and suddenly the lights went out. And they were in the dark. And so he preached Christ's statement, I am the light of the world. And he said afterwards, 2 people came up to him and thanked him. One of them was saved in the first part of the service, and the other one was saved in the third point. So that story is interesting. It has nothing to do with what I'm going to do, because I'm going with the text that I came in with, which is a very good one. He said, Jim said, it's the ultimate. Well, in a way it is. This is Paul's doxology with which he finishes the book. And so he comes to the end, and it's as though we're lifted to the heights. Romans chapter 16, verse 21 through 27. You want to know what we're going to teach after this, I think. So I think I'm going to do the book of Mark in a few weeks, so to answer Jim's request. Romans 16, beginning with verse 21, Timothy, my fellow worker, greets you, and so do Lucius and Jason and Sosipater, my kinsman. I, Tertius, who wrote this letter, greet you in the Lord. Gaius, host to me and to the whole church, greets you. Erastus, the city treasurer, greets you, and Quartus, the brother. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which has been kept secret for long ages past, but now is manifested, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the eternal God, has been made known to all the nations, leading to obedience of faith. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's pray. A generation ago, A.W. Tozer worried that the church had lost her once lofty concept of God, and then wrote that no people ever rise higher than their idea of God. A true understanding of God is a lofty concept of God, and it's crucial to have if we are to rise, if we are to think clearly and live well. We find that lofty concept of God in the book of Romans, and certainly in the last verses of the book. They are Paul's doxology, his praise to God, and they magnify the Lord as well as weak human words are able. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be glory forever. Amen. It is certainly a fitting way to end this great book in which Paul has explained the gospel of salvation in its broadest meaning and in a logical way. He first stated the major theme of the book, justification by faith, which is the gospel, the power of God for salvation. Then he explained man's need for the gospel, exposing our sin and guilt and utter inability to save ourselves by obedience to the law. We need righteousness. We have none, and we cannot produce any. At the end of chapter 3 and through chapter 4, Paul explains that the righteousness of God has been set forth in the cross. It has been purchased at the cross. It's been purchased for all who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ because it is received through faith alone. From chapter 5 on, we are seen as the people of God, people who have believed in Christ and are at peace with God through the sacrifice of Christ and are able to say, if God is for us, who is against us? Now that is security in this world. And that's what we have in Christ. In chapters 9 through 11, Paul gives us something of a parenthesis in the book and demonstrates God's unchangeableness and his faithfulness to Israel. The gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Chapter 11, verse 29. That's written in regard to Israel and its future, but that is true for all of God's people. Then he states our obligations to God in the rest of the book, and all of it leads to this final doxology, to God be the glory. But first, before Paul gives his concluding praise to God, he sends more greetings to his friends. He has already given his own personal greetings to 26 people in Rome. Now he passes on greetings from 8 companions who were with him there in Corinth. Among them were Timothy, his spiritual son, Gaius, his host, and Tertius, who was his secretary. Timothy is well known to us. He was from Lystra in southern Asia Minor, the son of a Jewish mother and a Greek father. He was converted through Paul's preaching, and he became Paul's assistant in the ministry. Little is known of the next three, Lucius and Jason and Sosipater. Paul calls them his kinsmen, fellow Jews. They may have been converts from Macedonia. Tertius gives his greeting in verse 22 and identifies himself as the one who wrote the letter, meaning he was Paul's amanuensis, his scribe. Paul often dictated letters and then periodically would end the letter with his own handwriting. He might write the last few verses. In fact, the book of Galatians is an example of that. Tertius may have been the brother of Quartus. And we say that because Paul describes Quartus in verse 23 as the brother of Tertius, we assume. Erastus was the treasurer of the city, so an important person in Corinth. All of these, along with the whole church of Corinth, sent their greetings to Rome. It's an interesting group that gathered in the room with Paul. We, again, know very little about most of them, but their names reflect the makeup of the church. They are Latin, Greek, and Jewish names. Altogether with Paul, and all with a common concern for the church in Rome, eager to send their greetings to their Christian brethren there. What that shows is what we considered a couple of weeks ago, that these early Christians were a diverse group, Jews and Gentiles, but united and having affection for one another. And we should have a mutual affection and concern for one another as well. We are all brothers in Christ. We are men and women with a unity and a common Heavenly Father, a common destiny, a common mission. The ministry is personal. It's not some abstract thing. It deals with people. And we are all part of the ministry. I've stressed that before, but it's worth stressing again. Every one of us have a place in the body of Christ, a place that functions, and we are to act on that, and we are to act in love and help toward one another. We're brothers in Christ, as I say, with a common destiny and common mission, and we are all part of the ministry, so our relationships with one another are very important, of eternal importance. They were important to Paul. They were important to his friends there in Corinth. They should be to us. When they are important, when we function as a church, as a body, when we do what Paul has stressed so much in the previous chapters, being unified, then we display the work of God's grace and the glory that He deserves, because that brings great glory to God, to be a people united and concerned. And that's the goal of God's people, to bring glory to Him. That's the purpose of all things. Westminster Shorter Catechism stated that in its famous first question, what is the chief end of man? Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Paul believed that. In an earlier expression of praise, Paul said in chapter 11 and verse 36, "For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be the glory forever. Amen." And he now makes that his final declaration as he concludes his greatest epistle with his longest doxology. Bishop Mole called it a rapturous doxology. It praises God for His power and His wisdom as they manifested His work in salvation among the nations. His statement in verse 25, "Now to Him who is able to establish you," is something of a shift from His instruction, the instruction He has given, which can't itself strengthen us, to God, whose power does, in fact, strengthen us. He is able, Paul says. A simple statement, but those are great words. God is able. He is able to do all things. There is no limit to His ability. Now, there are limits on God. God cannot deny Himself. God cannot contradict Himself. Twice we're told, and once in Titus chapter 1 and verse 2, and the second time in Hebrews chapter 6, God cannot lie. That's impossible for Him. So there are things that God cannot do, but God cannot fail. God cannot limit Himself. He is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. That is the God who is working on our behalf. In fact, Paul states in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20 that He is able to do far more exceedingly beyond all that we ask or think according to the power that works within us. What an amazing thought that is. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God lives within you, and that great power is working within you. The problem is never with God's power or ability. It's with our imperfect understanding of His power and purpose and our lack of trust in His design to bless. Many examples of great faith and a lack of faith in the Bible. I came across two of them, very familiar examples in the Bible. I was reading through 1 Samuel and came to chapters 13 and 14, and there you have it. Saul and Jonathan, two studies in a contrast of faith or lack of faith. Saul was a man with great privilege, but he was a weak man who leaned on the flesh, trusted in numbers, couldn't trust in the Lord, and so because he didn't believe in the God who is great and in His greatness, he failed and was disobedient. But then there's Jonathan, who comes to Michmash, and there is this garrison of Philistines, and Jonathan says to his armor bearer, "Let's go up and let's fight. Two of them against a host of Philistines." He said, "Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving by many or by few." God can use an army to rout an army, or God can use a few to win a great battle. And so in that faith in a great God, Jonathan went up and he slew the Philistines. That's the God that Paul says is able. That's how he praises Him. The God who is able, and what is specifically said about Him that He is able to do is establish us. That is, to make us firm and constant, to keep us from falling morally, spiritually. Paul has been warning the Romans against false brothers, false teachers, But he's not only concerned that they escape the influence of spiritual seducers. He wanted them strong. He wanted these Romans stable. He wanted them established in the faith and established in life. Back in chapter 1 and in verse 11, Paul stated that when he came to Rome, he hoped to establish them. But he acknowledges here that he could do that only by God's help. Ultimately, that is God's work. And the same doctrine is reflected in the doxologies or prayers that end other books. For example, the author of Hebrews writes in Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21, "Now the God of peace equip you in every good thing to do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight." It's God, the God of peace, who equips us for every good work. Jude wrote, "Now to him who is able," and there we have that same, the same words that Paul uses, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy." All the writers agree, God equips us for every good thing. He keeps us from stumbling. He establishes us. He makes us firm in the faith. He makes us constant and reliable in our conduct. But he establishes us through the ministry of his word. Here Paul says it happens according to my gospel, which he explains as the preaching of Jesus Christ. It's what Paul has explained in the book of Romans. Christ, his person and his work. That is a broad subject. That's a broad range of doctrines that Paul has covered in the book of Romans. But central to all of it is Jesus Christ. Then he adds that we are established according to the revelation of the mystery which has been kept secret for long ages past. There's something about the preaching of Christ that was a mystery. Now, in the Bible, a mystery is not something that is mysterious. It is a truth that could not be known except by revelation. It is a secret that has now been revealed. Paul explains the mystery more fully in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 6, where he wrote that Gentiles are fellow heirs and fellow members of the body and fellow partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. The mystery is not Gentile salvation. Gentiles were saved in the Old Testament, but they entered salvation through Israel by becoming Jews, by taking upon themselves all of the duties, the requirements of the Mosaic covenant. Rahab and Ruth both became Israelites. But now it's different. Gentiles are equal with Jews in the body of Christ. Jews are not preeminent over Gentiles. Gentiles are not preeminent over Jews. We are all equally in Christ. We enter into Christ in the same way, by grace, through faith. And this is now manifested, Paul says in verse 26. This mystery that was previously hidden in ages past has been made known in the present by the scriptures of the prophets, or by the prophetic writings, which are the writings of the apostles that he's referring to here. So the mystery is that we are in Christ and Christ is in us. We, both Jew and Gentile alike, are indwelt with the Holy Spirit. Every one of us, Jew or Gentile alike, at the moment of faith are sealed with the Holy Spirit. And we have a common destiny. There's still a kingdom for Israel. God will keep his promise to the nation. He is faithful to his word. The gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. He has made that point. But we will share equally in their inheritance. We Gentiles, as believers in Christ, will share equally in it because we, as Paul explained in chapter 11, have been grafted into their olive tree. We partake of all of the promises and the blessings that God has given to that nation. Gentile believers are equal partners with believing Jews now and in the future, and in the age to come. That is now manifested, Paul says, manifested in the scriptures, but also in the churches, in the church in Rome, where both Jews and Gentiles were living united in one body. That is really the basis for Paul's call for unity in the church, what he emphasized so much in the earlier chapters, which is an example of how God uses his word to sanctify us. They were experiencing some disunity, the weaker brother with the stronger brother. He counseled them. He used God's word to do that, and that's what the word of God does. It's the means God uses to sanctify us, to correct us, and lead us into good and godly behavior. Now, Paul says the mystery, which is a revelation of grace, has been made known to all the nations, leading to obedience of faith, the obedience which is faith. The boundaries have been broken down. The gospel is now to be proclaimed everywhere so that people everywhere might hear and believe. There are no restrictions. The gospel applies universally. It is for all who believe, all who obey God's call to come, to receive the gospel, to trust in Christ. That's God's grace. It is apart from works. It is apart from human achievement. It is apart from heredity. As Paul says, it is the gospel of grace, broadly speaking, this Christian doctrine that is the means God uses to establish us and cause us to mature in the faith. Now, it's God who does it. And that's what Paul has been emphasizing here. Our strength, our success is in the Lord God, but he uses means to do that. He uses the scriptures. But it is him through the scriptures that does it. And that's the stress that Paul is making here in this doxology. It is God who is able to establish you. It's not other people, not even other teachers, not even the most orthodox and corrective teachers. It is God working through his word. And so we are always to be looking to him, not to men, not even to good men. He is working through his word, and that's what we're to look to. And it's as we lean on the Lord that we grow strong. It's as we learn his word and obey him, live by faith in him, as we are nourished, our souls are fed through the word of God, as we are obedient to the things that we read and learn, we grow increasingly stronger. That's maturity. That's how it happens. So study. Do you want to be grounded in the faith? Do you want to be grounded well in life and not stumble? Then be students of God's word. It is the greatest investment we can make in this life, and it always pays off. There's a story that I love. I've told it before, but it's a story that B.B. Warfield told to illustrate the value of children learning the shorter catechism of the Westminster Confession of Faith. But it applies to all ages of people, young and old alike. And the story occurred in the 1800s. An officer in the United States Army was in a great western town. Warfield doesn't identify the town, just a great western town. And he was there during a time of violent riots. The streets were overrun with crime and dangerous people. One day, the officer saw a man walking down the street through all of this with an uncommon calmness, a firmness of bearing. As the officer passed the man, he couldn't help but turn around and look at him. And when he did, he saw that the stranger had done the same thing. And having noticed the officer looking at him, the man had stopped and began to approach him. And touched the officer's chest with his forefinger and said, "What is the chief end of man?" He replied, "Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever." "Ah," the man said, "I knew you were a shorter catechism boy by your looks." And the officer replied, "Well, that's just what I was thinking of you." Warfield concludes, It is worthwhile to be a shorter catechism boy. They grow to be men. And better than that, they're exceedingly apt to grow to be men of God. People do not rise higher than their view of God. And as we study God's Word and learn its doctrines, we find in all of that study, in all of the revelation of God, we find a big God, we find a great God who is able and more than able. That is certainly the God of the book of Romans. He is the absolute sovereign God who knows the end from the beginning and knows all things. Why does he know all things? Because he has planned all things, ordained all things. Donald Gray Barnhouse wrote in the last chapter of his commentary on Romans, "The sovereignty of God is the most important of all theological doctrines." Well, they're all important and they all have their place, but I would certainly agree the sovereignty of God is certainly a very, very important theological doctrine. It is vitally important. We cannot give all glory to Him if He is not absolutely sovereign. And we can have no assurance of hope in the present or in the future if He is not sovereign. So there's no greater comfort than the sovereignty of God. That God is in control of this world, that God is in control of all the details of your life and my life, and He is working them all out to a good and glorious end. And we know that all is working for good because the all-powerful God is also the all-wise God. He's not simply brute force. That would be a terrifying thing if God were just power, if we were just like twigs in a great machine. His power, His great power, is governed by His great wisdom, so that His power is used perfectly, both for the good of His people and for His own glory. So having praised God's power, Paul ends his doxology in verse 27 on the attribute of God's wisdom. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. That statement, the only wise God, expresses the fundamental truth of the Bible, that there's only one God. He is the Lord God. The Bible opens on that very point. That is the first statement of the Word of God. In the beginning, God. We have a beginning. God doesn't. He is eternal. He is self-sustaining, self-existent. He is the only God. He is the triune God. And as Paul comes to the end of his book, he draws attention to that fundamental truth. There is only one God, and all of the glory goes to Him. Faithfulness to that truth is tested in every age. In the years after Paul wrote these words, the faithfulness of the early church was severely tested by the Caesars. It was an age of polytheism and a pluralistic age. People were allowed to worship various gods, competing gods. They were allowed to worship Jesus. But they also were required to show their loyalty to the empire by declaring Caesar as Lord. Christians could not do that. The Bible demands that all glory and worship go to God alone. As a result, a lot of Christian blood was shed throughout the empire. But that is what these words require. Single devotion to the one God who is our Creator and Savior. We are to have no other gods before Him. The tests we face in the 21st century are different from those that were faced in the first century, and yet really much the same. Ours is a secular world, yet it's filled with the gods of materialism that are constantly competing for our attention and our loyalty and our devotion. We are always tempted to bow to something like that, tempted to worship. But if we confess what Paul confessed here, that God is the only God, then we must give all the glory to Him, worship only Him, love Him with all our heart, soul, and mind. That means our lives are to be arranged for Him, for His service and worship. Which is the best life? The very best life. The Lord said that His yoke is easy, that His burden is light, and it is the best life because His ways are wise. He knows life better than we do. He's the creator of it. He's designed it all. And as we follow His ways, we are truly blessed. And it is God's wisdom that Paul is chiefly praising here. He is the only wise God. So, of course, it is wise to follow His ways, to live according to His wisdom. His wisdom is seen in many, many ways. In fact, I think the more perceptive we become, we see it everywhere, in everything. We see it in all His works. We see His wisdom in the things that are around us, the order and the beauty of nature. The heavens are telling of the glory of God, the psalmist said. But as great as that display of wisdom is, it is the wisdom that God revealed in the mystery that Paul has spoken of here that called forth this response of praise from Paul to the only wise God. That God's grace could abound to the Gentiles of all people and abound to them as it did, that amazed the Apostle Paul, a man who came out of Judaism steeped in the law and this sense of separation in which the Gentiles were dogs and on the outside the pale, and then he's brought into this to become the apostle to the Gentiles, and his whole mind was changed and he sees things he had never dreamed of in Gentile salvation. That, as I say, amazed him. They were lost. They were in utter darkness. They were separated from Christ. They were outside of Israel's covenants. They were without hope and without God in the world, as Paul told the Ephesians. They were the pagans. They were the heathens. But those same Gentiles have been brought near by the blood of Christ. And not only near, they have been made equals with the Jews in Christ. They've been made fellow heirs with Him. Only great wisdom could bring Jews and Gentiles together as equals in the same family with love for one another. Only God's unsearchable wisdom could bring about Gentile blessing as God has done through Jewish failure. That's what he explained in chapter 11. Breaking off natural branches of the olive tree in order to graft in wild branches. But through that ingrafting, by means of Gentile salvation, God will provoke Jews to jealousy and ultimately save Israel, and through that salvation of Israel, bless the whole world with blessing beyond anything the world has known. Now that is a plan of wisdom that astonished the Apostle Paul. But every aspect of God's plan of salvation shows great wisdom. It confounds the wisdom of the world and makes the wisdom of the world look foolish. Wisdom is a branch of knowledge. It is the skillful use of knowledge in selecting and adapting the right means for fulfilling the best purpose. To understand the greatness of God's wisdom in salvation, we must understand the greatness of the problem that His wisdom solved, which was how to preserve God's righteousness, how to preserve God's justice while saving sinful people. How can a holy God forgive sinners and remain holy? He cannot ignore sin, can't simply wink at sin and pretend it didn't happen. That would be unjust, that would be unholy. He must deal with sin, but he cannot at the same time ignore sinners because God is love. It is his nature to be merciful. And so the problem to be solved was how to save sinners and be just in doing it. Or to use the words of chapter 3, how to be just and the justifier. And God's solution was found in a substitute. and the only substitute that there could be, his own son, who was qualified to represent men because he became a man and a perfect man and able to save not only another man, but a whole multitude of men and women, and an innumerable multitude, because he is not only man, he is God, the eternal Son of God. He made a perfect sacrifice, which demonstrated God's glory in his love and justice, which has been said, kissed at the cross to save Jews and Gentiles alike. That is a plan that man could not have imagined or implemented. And so Paul says, to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. It is glory that is through Jesus Christ, because it is only through Jesus Christ that we can know God and approach Him. He said that Himself. In John chapter 14 and verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. We cannot know God the Father unless we know God the Son. God is not known and glorified apart from faith in Jesus Christ as God's eternal Son and unique Son and our personal Savior. Salvation is only in Him. That's the great theme of this book. And to that theme and to all the truth of this great book, what the Swiss commentator Frederick Godet called the cathedral of the Christian faith, to all of this book of Romans, Paul says, Amen. That means it is all true and I believe it. I fix my seal upon it. Do you do that? Do you agree and say amen to all that Paul has written in this doxology and what he's written in this great epistle? Have you believed in Jesus Christ as your Savior? If not, then we invite you to do so. It's necessary that you do so. Because as Paul said, the wages of sin is death, and we are all sinners and we are all guilty. Death is what is required by sin. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, if you've not put your faith in Christ, we invite you, receive Him. Receive the free gift of life in Christ, and then by your words and by your deeds, give all the glory to God. God help you to do that. Well, we conclude this great book of Romans this morning, and I think a fitting way to end our study is with hymn number 241 in the red book, To God Be the Glory. Let's stand and sing that and then remain standing for the benediction.